The steam locomotive, perhaps one of the most iconic of man's creation. Nothing is as alive or thrilling as the sights and sounds of a steam locomotive rolling throughout the landscape. Though their days are outnumbered, many of these grand giants have found a new life outside of their revenue career, being cared for by preservationists to teach the importance of the iron horse for generations to come. Out of the hundreds of types of these machines, to make it into preservation, one such kind of these wonderful machines is the Reading Railroad Company T-1 locomotives. Today, only four of these sturdy original locomotives live on to tell their story in the long-lived days of steam. Engine number 2100, 2101, 2102, and 2124. This is the story of the Reading Ramblers. The Reading 484 T1 locomotives were originally built out of 30 I-10SA 280 consolidations. The I-10SA class 280 was originally built in 1923 by the Baldwin Locomotive Works. These 50 engines would be numbered 2000 to 2049. The I-10s served the Reading, hauling freight. It's now the early 1940s. World War II has already broken out, and the United States government has placed many restrictions on the U.S. railroads on what they can invest their money into. The wartime freight traffic has taken a heavy toll on the Reading. They were in desperate need of a more powerful locomotive. However, the United States Railroad Administration wouldn't allow the railroad to invest the money into developing a new type of locomotive. However, the Reading's president at the time, Ravel W. Brown, found a loophole in his company. He could rebuild his 280 locomotives into big and larger as long as they had the serial numbers to classify the locomotives as a class rebuild. The Reading Railroad would take 30 of their I-10SA 280s and rebuild them at the company shops in Reading, Pennsylvania. The Reading would refit their smaller locomotives into massive, monstrous 484 Northerns, dubbed T1. The first I-10 to be rebuilt would be engine number 2020. On August 6th, 1945, she would be the prototype for the next 30 Northerns, engine number 2100. Between 1945 and 1947, the Reading would continue to rebuild their I-10SA class into T1s, number 2100 to 2129. With their first 20 going into freight service and the final 10 being equipped for passenger service, the T1s proved themselves to be mighty workhorses on the Reading. It has been said that they have the ability to pull a train up to 150 cars. The T1s managed to stay in service with the Reading up until the early 1950s. Railroads across the U.S. began moving in the direction of diesel locomotives. By the mid-1950s, the Reading would retire all but five T1s, engines numbered 2100, 2101, 2102, 2123, and 2124 for special events.
In 1959, the Reading Railroad surprisingly announced that they wanted to run a series of excursions with steam locomotives. T1s number 2100, 2101, 2102, 2123, and 2124 would be retained by the railroad for these trips. Engines numbered 2100, 2102, and 2124 would go on to become the stars of the show, while 2101 would become a backup engine, and 2123 would become a parts source. The Reading would run a total of 50 trips over the course of 5 years from 1959 to 1964. By the end of 1964, due to operating problems and management change, the Reading would end these trips and retire all five T1s for good. locomotives 2100, 2101, and 2123 would be sold to Strigel Supply and Equipment, with 2123 eventually being cut up for scrap. 2102 would be sold to Bill Benson of Steam Tours USA, and 2124 would be sold to rail enthusiast F. Nelson Blount and added to his Steamtown collection in Belleau Falls, Vermont. Today, the 2124 sits cold and idle at Steamtown's new location in Scranton, Pennsylvania. Though life for this iron horse has been quiet since her glory days, T-1's 2100, 2101, and 2102 would go on to have quite the career after the Rambles.
After being stored at the Strigel Supply and Equipment, 2100 and 2101 would become battered, beaten shells of their former glory selves. In 1975, Ross Rolland Jr. was in desperate need of finding an engine to haul his American Freedom Train, a rolling museum loaded with rich U.S. history in 1975. Ross Rolland would purchase both the 2100 and the 2101 for the project, being in better condition since she was used as a backup engine. 2101 was picked out of the two sisters to be restored. In February 1975, the 2101 would go from a junkyard mess to a fully functioning steam engine in what would be dubbed Miracle 30. From April 1975 to 1976, the 2101 would haul the Freedom Train, along with Southern Pacific GS4 4449 and Texas and Pacific 610. After the Freedom Train ended in 1977, the 2101 would be repainted as Chessie Steam Special 2101 and haul several excursions over the New River Gorge route as part of the 150th birthday of the railroads in America. These would become some of the engine's most successful trips. These trips proved to be very popular among rail fans, that the Chessie system would host another season of trips in 1978. After being extensively rebuilt, the 2101 would go back to hauling trips for the Chessie system until disaster would strike. In 1979, while being stored at a roundhouse in Kentucky, 2101 would be involved with a nasty roundhouse fire, destroying the engine. Her owner, Ross Rolland, figured out that she would be too expensive to repair. She would be cosmetically restored and donated to the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad Museum and traded for a green briar from the Chesapeake and Ohio number 614. Ever since then, the 2101 sat at the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad Museum, quiet and neglected.
Compared to the other T-Hogs, 2102 probably had the longest and most consistent career out of all the locomotives. After the Reading Rambles concluded in 1964, 2102 was kept in storage until 1966, when she was sold to Mr. Bill Benson of Steam Tours USA, based in Akron, Ohio. After over a year of hard work that took place at the ex-Penzi Roundhouse in Akron, 2102 would eventually return to service in 1967. For the next 8 years, the veteran T-Hog would be running trips around the eastern half of the United States. Amongst the trips it pulled in that period, it performed a run to Detroit in 1969 and surprisingly came out not vandalized and not full of bullet holes. Surprising. The big engine also made a visit to West Virginia in 1971, along the line that would later become the Durban and Greenbrier, the same line that the Cass Scenic Railroad operates on. And if you ask me, it's a nice change from the overload of geared steam there. Don't kill me in the comments over that. In 1972, 2102 was leased by Ross Rolland's High Iron Company, where it performed a bunch of excursions, including one overnight trip from Elizabeth, New Jersey to Washington, D.C. In 1973, in order to celebrate the 150th birthday of the Delaware and Hudson Railroad, 2102 was cosmetically disguised as Delaware and Hudson K62-484 Northern number 302, a masquerade which is now met with widespread disapproval and disdain from many rail fans, even though in my opinion it looks absolutely amazing. 2102 was not alone as Steamtown's CP Pacific 1278 was also disguised as the D&H Pacific 653, which included a doubleheader. 2102 would remain in that scheme for the rest of the 1973 season. 1977 saw the 2102 doublehead with Grand Trunk Western 282 Mikado number 4070 along the Horseshoe Curve. It would be another 35 years before another steam locomotive, that being 765, would traverse the famous Penzi Curve, mostly under her own traction. On that trip, 4070 would suffer a broken eccentric rung, and 2102 would have to slug the train for the rest of the journey. Eventually, in 1985, the Big T-Hog would be sold to Mr. Andy Muller of the Blue Mountain and Reading Railroad, that at the time ran between Temple and Hamburg, Pennsylvania. For the next 6 years, she would operate along the ever-so-expanding line alongside former Gulf Mobile and Ohio Pacific 425. In 1987, 2102 wore a special livery on her tender commemorating the 200th anniversary of the U.S. Constitution. In 1991, it would operate along many of the former Reading lines, including a trip along the Perkiomen branch and another along SEPTA rails to Norristown, Pennsylvania. Sadly, 1991 would be the last year that the locomotive operated since her flues expired that year. It was eventually moved to Steamtown in 1995 for a restoration that never happened, unsurprisingly. And in 1997, it was returned to what is known as the Reading and Northern, where it sat on display at Port Clinton for the next 19 years. However, in 2016, it was announced that the Mighty T-Hog would be restored to operation. As of 2020, the restoration is nearing completion, with most of 2102's firebox stay bolts fitted into the firebox, and what looks like a new trailing truck, 2102 will eventually rumble along the rails once more in the not-so-distant future.
Of the T-1s that have survived, the first of the T-Hog's fleet, number 2100, was probably the unluckiest of the survivors. Long story short, after the Iron Horse Rambles ended, she would stay in storage more than under operation. 1 year after the Rambles ended, the 2100 and her sister, the 2101, will sit at the Strigo Supply and Equipment in Baltimore until Ross Rowland purchased the two in 1975 for his American Freedom Train project. 2100 was used as a donor locomotive for the 2101's restoration and operation. The 2100 was in storage at Hagerstown, Maryland during the Freedom Train until 1987, when she was sold to the 2100 Corporation. The locomotive was overhauled at Hagerstown at a cost of $1 million with plans to operate once again. However, no railroad was found that would agree to accommodate a 484 like the 2100. In 1988, the 2100 was purchased and restored to operation by the CEO of Lionel Trains, which at the time was Richard Kuhn. Unfortunately for Kuhn, his ownership of the locomotive wasn't to last long. Over the next few decades, the 2100 would be sold to multiple owners until she was acquired by Thomas Paine, who moved her to a former New York Central locomotive shop in St. Thomas, Ontario, Canada. Unfortunately, Paine is mainly looked down upon in the rail fan community when he gave the locomotive this bad look. They gave it ditch lights, which was mandatory for Canadian railway regulations, and Paine had the locomotive converted to oil firing, which destroyed the locomotive's performance because Paine didn't convert it properly. The locomotive's boiler pressure drastically dropped, which also caused the whistle to sound terrible. Paine had plans to operate the 2100 in the Rocky Mountains in Canada, but those plans never came to be. In 2005, Paine moved the 2100 to Tacoma, Washington on a short-lived line known as the Golden Pacific Railroad. The 2100 struggled pulling the Tacoma Sightseer excursion trains up until 2008, when she was moved to a siding in Richland, Washington, where she sat with a bleak future. However, in 2014, the 2100's future started to shine once again. The American Steam Railroad signed a lease for the 2100, and in 2015 she was moved to Cleveland, Ohio, and began restoration back to service. She'll be given her old Reading livery back, as well as being reconverted back to coal. It is said that the 2100 might return to steam in 2021, but for now she rests.
As of 2020, Reading T1s number 2100 and 2102 have been getting closer and closer to return to the High Iron once more, but their respected organization and railroad. Engine 2124 sits at Steamtown USA's collection in Scranton, Pennsylvania. Recently, the engine was given a cosmetic rebuild and put back into her Ramblers scheme. As for the 2101, she still resides at the B&O Railroad Museum in deplorable shape. It's easy to say that the Reading T1 is a class of locomotive that has implemented its place in railroad history.